I painted a miniature the other day, realizing how many different things not only go on in my head, decisions taken while painting, but also the multitude of things that just pass through my brush. This is something that is quite difficult to convey in a YouTube-friendly format. Most often we have a specific theme like painting eyes, and that's it. Because it would be really difficult to find the eye painting tutorial if all of them were named "I painted a miniature the other day, part 23. Other times we have broader themes, maybe focusing on a color or a concept, trying to convey additional inspirational thoughts while painting something. Videos like this are not troubleshooting, per se, just videos that hopefully get people painting. Now, these two statements are obviously not always the case, but let's just say they are, for argument's sake. And based on that, I sometimes get the feeling that our content can be slightly misleading. How painting one part of the miniature can affect how the next is painted. How we go back and forth, gradually building up a miniature. How not only one, but many different techniques are used for different purposes. So I thought I'd just talk about this miniature I painted the other day. This one was a bit different. I wanted to do white armor. Tricky. So a white base coat would be the best place to start, although being quite unfond of a fully white base coat, I did a very excessive zenithal type prime. Essentially, I just wanted there to still be a hint of black or grey left under the cloak and under the armpits and that. My plan with the armour was essentially to start with an off-white, tone down the recesses and eventually build up the highlights. I experimented my way to a mix of Scalecolour's instant paints, their contrast style paint range. This combination of dark green, blue black and grey gave me a slightly cool grey shade. Diluted with Citadel contrast medium, in my opinion, this makes this paint flow more evenly, becomes more paintable, but also dilutes. These transparent-ish paints toned down the white, giving me some more character and depth. And while the instant was drying, I applied the base layer on the cloak, an icy turquoise blue. First a thick and then a thin layer. My idea here is that this angry, hammer-wielding gentleman I have a somewhat camouflage theme going in my army was recruited at the last minute. Which is true, he's the last addition to my army. But there was no time for him to change armor, his last campaign being in a wintry environment, so he's stuck in ice fatigues, so to speak. Anyway, back to the white armor while the cloak dries. I really like using these liquid pigments. They dry with a textured grainy surface that to me adds texture to something like armor. Diluted with water that has a drop of washing up liquid in it makes it a little easier to paint on, going over the shaded areas of the armor that are facing upwards, warming them a little, but also adding texture. I also used water to create gradients and remove excessiveness. And while that dries, I went back and created a dark shade glaze for the cloak, using my favorite shading gray mixed with the original blue. A shading paint in my terminology is something that works real well to shade many different colors, and a glaze is a paint watered down to obscenity. I shaded the areas that probably would be a little shaded, if there was an imaginary sky over this hammering hero. I then felt like I needed to block out some of the colors. I find it difficult to paint just the one area at a time to completion. I rather gradually build up paint all over the miniature, giving me a better sense of the whole thing. So I layered on the darkest base colors of all the different blocks on the rest of the miniature, as well as the edges of the things I knew I later on was going to wet blend. Wet blending can be a bit messy, so at the edges of whatever I'm going to wet blend, like where there's some tools meeting the cloak, for example, I just layer on the base color, normally, saving me trouble ahead. This also being more of a thing on this mini that was primed white than on a mini primed black. Filling in these colors gave me a slightly better feel of the whole, and an urge to tone down all the absolutely shaded areas of the white armor arose. So I went in with a very diluted Eclipse gray under the shoulder pads and under the armpits and so on. It was then time to do some, quote, non-metallic metal, unquote, essentially trying to mimic the surface of metal by using regular paints, going for a worn, coppery weaponry and tools ranging from grey to orange to almost yellow. I like to use wet blending as a foundation for this type of non-metallic metal. The coarse surface just makes the metal come a little bit more alive in my eye. I'm not going for realism here, just a sense of metal and cool looks. After the first, we can call it wet blend sketch, I go in with the orange paint thinned down and start enforcing, building up whatever it is just happened during the wet blend frenzy. Now using more of a layering process, eventually adding more and more pale yellow to the mix on smaller and smaller surfaces, building up gradients that represent the shine of the metal, eventually ending in undiluted yellow. I have a similar approach to everything leather, wet blending grey and brown, trying to get shades and highlights, but also a sense of wear and tear. After the first wet blend sketch is done, I go in with the brighter mixture, the original brown with some yellow added, and do sort of stabbing, stitching motions, trying to mimic cracked and worn leather. Oil goes on the ballistas, not on keeping the leather soft. I then finish off my other details with regular layers of brighter and brighter paints, the base a very dark blue that I highlight with brighter and brighter blues and eventually an almost white, trying to make them look slightly metallic, at least slightly shiny. And then it's time for skin. The base colour was a petroleum grey that I now want to warm up in places using a reddish brown colour. Not covering things completely, trying to leave some of the original dark grey in the recesses to get as many complexities into the skin as possible. I decided a while back to use all the different faces that pass my painting desk as possibilities to practice different skin tones. This being my first very dark skin tone. Something of a challenge. Highlighting too much and it no longer looks dark. Highlighting too little and, like with anything, looks a bit uninteresting. I mixed a warm brown, the red brown and the base grey and started working up different shapes and highlights on the face. First doing some warmer layers with more of the warm brown, then adding more of the red and the grey and an additional wonderful all-round highlight colour of mine called Moonray Flesh, making the brighter highlights less yellow-brown and more burgundy-greyish. All-round highlight colour being my terminology to a paint that works well to brighten many paints, the opposite of the grey I mentioned earlier. Anyway, I did keep the highlighted areas pretty small, but still surprised myself with how bright I could take the highlights without ruining the feel of dark skin. As a final warming up of parts of the skin, I used a paint aptly called African skin, watered down to a glaze that I used pretty much only on the skin closest to the hair. Talking about hair, I was thinking of orange hair for this fellow. Figured it would work nicely in the scheme of things. I just needed to make sure it was a very different orange to the copper. So the red base was a start, but I also added some purple to the absolute shadows or recesses of the hair. Then, just adding layer by layer of brighter and brighter orange paint. I'm doing lots of thin strokes, in a way trying to build up volume or the sense of actual hair, purposely making sure that no layer is completely covered, that there is still some red and purple visible in among all the orange, but also making the orange brighter on the top of the head and more shaded on the sides. Once I'd reached the point of almost yellow, I was still kind of thinking, looks like carrot. So I mixed red and yellow ink into, an orange, applying only to the really orange bits of the hair, giving some more saturation and, for lack of a better term, oomph. As most of my Stormcast, this fellow is going to get loony eyes. I kind of didn't want to do the eyes before the hair, or the cloak, for that matter. Going for a turquoise-type glow, wanting colours that complements the orange hair, but at the same time doesn't look too much like the cloak. A reason I have not highlighted the cloak yet, by the way. I usually do these by first getting some white into the pupil area, then working in reverse, starting with the furthest reach of glow or light, so the darkest paint, a green, I believe. Then working my way closer and closer towards the centre of the eye, using brighter and brighter paints on smaller and smaller areas, going from the dark green to turquoise to white. As usual at this stage, I was concentrating and my camera forgot to tell me not to lean over too far, resulting in a lot of hair. So this is a bit of a hey presto moment, but you get the concept, I hope. So now I could highlight the cloak. Going for a more icy pale blue, so as not to rob attention from the glowy eyes, but also to get more of a wintry feel. Trying to not highlight the areas I previously shaded, but also just doing things a little random. I highlighted the upper parts of a lot of little squares. Now, finally, I had a broader picture of what the white armour looked like, with everything else now in place, and started highlighting with pure white, a thin one, admittedly, doing a combination of wear and tear, battle damage, and highlights. Not really getting as white as I wanted, I then opted for white ink to go on the uppermost bits, like everything armoury on the top of the mini facing up. Still thinking the armour looked a bit flat, white, sure seems real tricky to get interesting, I diluted some teal-ish ink and went over the shadowy areas facing down, imagining some colder shadows on everything facing down, then thinking the opposite. I mixed a brown and yellow ink into something like a sepia that I, in diluted form, applied to some of the greyer areas facing up, like the sun up top would warm the armour a bit. I think I could have exaggerated these two effects even more, but I was a little afraid of not keeping the white armour white. Next step was getting a few oil paints on this. And in this case, not wanting to tint the underlying layer, I varnished the mini using a slightly diluted water-based varnish. With the oils, I'm looking to do some weathering, mainly. First off, using the Soilworks Rust Oil Wash to add rust to the armour. The fine thing here is that I can paint on the rust, then clean off my brush with white spirit, wipe off the excess amount of white spirit on a piece of paper, and then go back and clean up any of the rust I don't like, without leaving any staining on the underlying surface. Same process goes for the verdigris oil wash I mixed myself. Oil paint with a lot of white spirit, basically. Adding a bit of fun and depth to the hammers, with the possibility to remove anything excessive without staining the copper underneath. I made a brown wash for the leathery shafts and gloves just to enhance the shading on the sides pointing down. I pretty much smeared it on and then wiped off some of the highlights, making sure there wasn't anything on the surfaces pointing up. Oil paints, fool's guess here, but probably something to do with not containing so many different pigments, can be very saturated. So I went for it and painted some more orange on the hair, still feeling that it was not orange enough. Just teasing in a bit more saturation. And while I was up there, I kind of felt the skin could be highlighted just a tad more. So I tried to mix some oil paints, roughly matching the skin highlight tone. The beautiful thing with oils is that one can work quite differently than with acrylics. For one, there's no rush. This stuff won't dry for hours. Secondly, as in this case, I used a subtractive method of painting. In a sense, smearing on too much, cleaning my brush in white spirit, and then cleaning off the excess off the mini. Often, because of the dilution with white spirit in the brush, a lovely gradient sort of automatically happens as well. I even tried to add a hint of orange to the eyebrows, thinking there must be hair there. If it's visible, and in that case a success, I'm not quite sure. With all that in place, the last thing I felt a need for was to highlight the cloak just a little bit more. I wanted to have a bit more of a smooth, luxurious, almost silky feel. This is arrogant aristocracy, after all. So I did the same thing here with a white oil paint, pretty much adding a blob of white, then going back with a clean brush and a hint of white spirit, smearing the side of the blob facing down into a nice gradient. The finishing touches were some dark brown pigment on the hem of the cloak and on the metallic boots. I do this before painting the base so as not to get too much pigment on a nicely painted base, but often go in with pigments again on the base once the base is painted. The base was an efficient wet blend with some highlighting on the stones. This, by the way, if you are into details, is the base from one of the Ballista crew, not something that comes in the box with this mini. A day or so later, once I was sure the oil paints were dry, I matte varnished the whole thing. Because that's my thing. So this probably was not fully as visually impressive as some of my videos. But I felt that I wanted to put what I'm doing into a bit of context. Painting this miniature could easily have resulted in videos like painting white armour, painting dark skin, highlighting with oils, non-metallic metal copper, painting glowy eyes, wet blend your base. But painting a miniature isn't always like that. A lot of the things we do just happen along the way, just for the fun of it, or as part of a growing equation. In the end, when painting, I try and remember to paint with everything I've got. Not all the paints, but with knowledge and experimentation. Using techniques not because I should or could, but as a means to an end. To not be afraid of just going for the idea I have in my head, trusting I can solve arising issues along the way, either on my own or with the help of those around me.